Welcome to the premiere episode of Brewlu TV. It turns out it's opening weekend for the Good Beer Company in Santa Ana. So I figured I'd come in here, have a couple of beers, and I'll check the place out, see what's doing. While I'm getting myself set up, why don't you guys check out this video from Julian Fox. He bought himself a new Edelmetal floor burner, and he did an unboxing for us. So check that out, and then I'll see you in a minute.
Hey, Brewlus, here we are in sunny New York for a change. It's about 60 degrees out, kind of day up here. I got a brand new Edelmetal brew burner from northernbrewer.com, my first propane floor burner. So I thought I'd bring you in here on the unboxing. So here we go. Let's see what this is about. Here we go. Here's the box. I can tell you that it weighs about 5 tons so far. And let's try and do this one-handed. Let's open this up. Let's see what's going on over here. Okay. Okay. Typical box in a box construction. We'll open this one up too. Okay. And we have more boxes inside other boxes. Okay, so let's take off this protective shipping layer. So then on the floor, what do we got in here? All nice and bubble wrapped. We got some instructions. Let's see. Brew burner, 72,000 BTUs. It's not like the most you can get, I suppose, but it'll do. Probably better than the kitchen stove. We got a hose and regulator here for the propane. Propane, which is back there, see the tank. And now we got the burner itself all nice and wrapped up here in the bubble wrap. Let's take this bad boy out and see what's going on. You can see here, I believe that's a banjo style burner maybe. Okay, it's ridiculously heavy. Let's see if I can one-hand it out of here. I don't think I can. So I'm gonna put this down for a sec. Hand it out of here. Okay, it also comes, you'll see here, with a pin valve regulator. I think that's one of the fabulous features. And here we are in all its glory. My new Edelmetal brew burner. Fancy, all copper clad, probably for no reason, but it looks cool. Nice and sturdy. Apparently it holds, 1,000 pounds at least. So I'm gonna hook it up and we'll see how it goes. See you later, Brewlus. Go, Boyle, go.
Hey, Nico, here at the Good Beer Company. You really can't see that, though, can you? There you go, the Good Beer Company.
There it is.
I'm here with Brandon Gonzalez, another one of the Brewlus. And we're drinking pale wheat with amarillo.
Yep,
very tasty. It's got a nice little dry hop on it. So tell me what you're thinking about it.
Very crisp on the palate, very nice, light. It's a solid pale wheat. It's. I don't normally drink pale wheats. It's something I don't come across too often, but this is something I can see myself drinking on a nice Sunday afternoon. It's delicious. What do you think?
This reminds me of a lot of hopped up Hess you see in homebrew.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because there's a lot of amarillo in the nose, which is not something normal commercial places do.
Yep.
And it's got a good amount of bitterness, but not enough to like go IPA with it.
No, not at all.
And I mean, it's pretty cloudy. I mean, not super, but it's not clear at all. Real nice color. It's a damn good beer. I give it a 3.5.
Out of 5. Okay. Yeah, I would probably say it's a 3.5, definitely. You could definitely tell it's homebrew inspired.
All right.
Like you were saying, you don't see this too much in commercial beers, so that's the nice thing about it. That's the nice thing that two people that started off as home brewers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Brandon and Dave started this place, and
well, most places do start off as home brewers.
That's what I meant, but I didn't say it.
No, but yeah, we know him. We know these guys from the homebrew circuit around here for quite a little while.
Yeah, it's a delicious 3.5 is a good accurate thing.
So, did you go to that Stefano's thing last week?
I didn't. No.
You didn't?
No, I was busy drinking beer at my house.
I've got a video of it. We can show these guys. You can check it out. See what you think of the place.
Absolutely. Let's do it.
Stefano's Golden Baked Hams. I forget where they are.
Yorba Linda.
Thank you. But they hosted a bottle share for the Brewlus last weekend. And trip out. In the deep, dark, fucking back alley of this place, Good Beer Company. They got the barrels all lined up, so it makes a nice little weird little alley, like a little dark, dank area. But you can totally watch the brewer working from back here, and that's why I got the angle back here. I don't even know the guy's name yet. We'll find out and get back at you later on. Hold on, I got a DJ Lexicon talking about this Saison. 1 second. Well, I promised him, and here he is, the locally world-famous DJ Lexicon.
All right, I'm here at Good Beer Company with my buddy Nico, and trying the Saison, my buddy Brandon, and I have to say I approve. Very light.
It's got a little more mouthfeel than I would expect.
Yes, and I love the carb on it.
It's nice.
It's really nice for a Saison. It's a little heavier Saison, I would say.
Yeah. The spices are a little more in the background than you would expect.
That's true. That's true. But I like the hoppiness. Nice balance there.
Totally works.
Yeah. And I like the mouthfeel. I mean, it's, you know, I like big Belgian, so this is like a gateway for me.
So what brings you behind you? Like, what brings you down here on opening weekend?
Well, Dave and Brandon, you know, we have some history. Go back, we did a, Brandon and I did a student film together, The Art of Beer. So that's how I came to meet Brandon. We were in the same.
I mean, where can I find this? I haven't heard of it.
Yeah, it's, you look up Art of Beer on the site, on the and it's talking about the local Orange County. Craft beer movement.
So search in Google Art of Beer and check out a student film about the local area.
Yeah, it's really good. So that's how I met Brandon, and for the film debut, he actually brought one of his saisons, and I started liking his saison focus at that point. So it was really good. So this is a good first offer.
Yeah, not bad at all.
I'm
only going to have two beers. I mean, this is way too bad. They're working on other beers. It's just, you know, you got to get open when you can get open. It's just business. So you homebrew a little bit too, don't you?
I do, and I focus strictly on Belgian stouts.
Okay.
So,
you've done a Belgian stout?
I have not done a Belgian stout.
I've had them, but not that.
I thought I could try that out.
Check that out.
I like that.
So I got a video coming up next.
Okay.
From Jen and Eric Forrest. Have you met them over at the meetings?
No, I haven't.
They're doing a pumpkin ale.
Okay.
So I'll let you check that out.
That sounds good.
You guys can check it out too.
All right.
Hi, my name is Eric. I'm the second half of Generic Brewing. My wife does most of the brewing, and I do most of the busy work. We brewed a pumpkin spice ale today. We used about 8 pounds two row and a couple of pounds of specialty malt. It's sitting here in front of me, already attenuating after 2 hours. Our process is all grain. Usually what we do is we boil water up to about 180 or so, which is about 3 or 4 gallons, depending on what recipe we're using. And we put the grains in a cooler that has been transformed into a mash tun. We pour the grains in there, pour the water in there, let it sit for an hour, 45 minutes to an hour, according to recipe. And then once we do, we put it up on a table, we sparge it into a boil kettle, and another 3 gallons at about 180 degrees, I would say, water. And then we slowly sparge, get all the sugars we can out of the grain, put it into the boil kettle. Usually around 7 gallons is what we shoot for. Anything extra or second runoff, I usually do a 2 gallon batch tester, I guess, to further our knowledge on brewing. We usually mess around with that little 2 gallons and do a little thing here and there. And then once we're done with that, of course we put it in the boil kettle, put it on the pot, then we add our hops, we get our boiler going, and start making beer. Once it's finished, put it in the carboy, like I said, which is in front of me. And then we have a regular bucket. I think it's a 17-gallon party tub with rope and ties. We fill it up with water, put the carboy inside, frozen water bottles, and you're all set. Usually, depending on how long you check or how often you check the barrel, we can get it in up down to about 60 degrees, which is pretty good for most of the ales we do. And being a prepper and green and reusing all of our stuff, usually we recirculate the water we use for cleaning our carboys, cleaning our kegs, also for recirculating our water with the wort chiller. We also have another pump and bucket system that we use for doing that. So this has been a good brew day, and as you'll see from our pictures, hopefully I've explained everything well enough, and have a good day.
I wonder, my little darling, where can you be again tonight while the moon is shining bright? I wonder. My heart is aching. Why for you can our love be mistaken? Darling, don't you say that this must mean our ending? I wonder. Baby, I've been through, lover's lane. I've been making life just the same. I've been traveling for miles around, trying to find the one I love. Come on, I wonder. Well, 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 little baby, will you think of me every day?
All right, Nico here. I'm down here at Hall Brewing where Tim did a batch of, what was it, Tim?
American Hemp.
With peaches. And we got a couple of new guys here learning the ropes, and they brought a couple of beers for us to drink. So why don't you guys introduce yourselves and tell us what you brought?
My name's Mike, and I brought a bottle of the collaboration with the brewery and the Three Floyds, the Rue de Floyd. Pop that open.
So what was the most important thing you guys thought you learned today? That's the most important thing, sure.
Probably how to properly transferring and chilling and the fermentation process from actually finished brewing to getting it cold enough and over here into the fermenter.
Alright. Yeah, see, Tim's using a plate chiller. That's a little different than what some of us use. Plate chiller has two passes, one for water that's cold and one for beer that's hot. And the cold water cools the beer as it goes through the coils and then comes out at pitching temperature. It's a fun little gadget, but you need a pump. It takes a little more equipment than your average immersion chiller. So what do we know about this beer?
This is a, an Imperial Porter aged in bourbon barrels with cherries, coffee, and vanilla beans added.
Nice. Now, I am a fan of the brewery, and I am a fan of Three Floyds, so I imagine this should be pretty good. I haven't had it. Oh, look at that. Oh, it's like chocolate milk going in here, man. Like, wow. Thank you.
Immediately get that bourbon note.
Oh yeah, it's bourbon and cask all day long, right off the bat. But I'm getting a little bit of chocolate and coffee to it too.
I definitely feel the coffee. I'm not getting any cherry or vanilla right away. On the nose.
I get vanilla, but maybe just because I know it's there. You know how that is.
Yeah.
It's
in the taste, though. You get hints of cherry on the back end.
Yeah. Oh yeah, there's the cherry.
Oh yeah.
It's almost like barrel-aged cordial. It's kind of what it tastes like.
Yeah.
It's a good description. Cordial cherry.
Mm-hmm. So those my mom always eat for Christmas, the chocolate covered with the cream inside.
Yeah, we can get enough of them at Christmas time.
Mm, good stuff.
Yeah, the vanilla is much softer. That cherry comes very pronounced.
Yeah, it's hidden in there. There's not a whole lot of vanilla I'm not getting. But it could be the barrel, because a lot of times barrel has vanilla-like characters. So it could just be you're mixing up the two, you know what I mean? It's kind of hiding behind a similar flavor.
Yeah.
But it's a really damn good beer. I mean, just first couple mouthfuls, I want to give it a 4 out of 5. What are you thinking?
I'd agree with that. Okay, I'd go with a 4.
I'll be 4.5. It'd be different.
So we're calling it a 4.5 average. It's a pretty damn good beer for right off the bat.
14.4%.
Oh, wow. I didn't think it was going to be that high.
And it's cold.
Yeah, it's not even the right serving temperature yet. Let that warm up a little bit. While we do, why don't you tell us a little bit about the system, Tim?
Well, I made it. It's called Herman.
Out of bed
frames. Those are cut up bed frames. I welded them together. Picked up a keg, hot liquor tank, Home Depot mash tun, and a 15-gallon stainless brew kettle.
Yeah, think about homebrewing, man. DIY. You can usually make something cheaper than you can buy it.
Well, I made a hop spider for about $12.
Yeah.
They cost about $30, I think.
Yeah, see, that's less than half price. Yeah. So what went in the beer?
It had 12 pounds of two row, 8 pounds of malted wheat, 2 ounces of Sterling hops at 60 minutes and 2 ounces at 30 minutes, and 2 cans of peach puree.
So why did you decide on a 60-minute and 30-minute addition?
I like the additions. I think it's a little bittering, a little bit of flavor for balance.
Okay. That works. All right, so the pressure of the camera's getting everybody, so let's just salute. We'll catch you guys next time.
Okay, so I'm still over here at Good Beer Company, but I got a hold of the owner, Brandon. How's it going?
Hey guys.
Cheers.
Cheers.
And we snuck into the private room, the conference room. You can rent this room out for private parties, but mostly, see, there's an office building upstairs, and this is like a conference room. Mm-hmm. You can probably tell more about that than I can.
Yeah, so we have a cool little co-tenant relationship with our offices upstairs. Monday through Friday, the offices are full and bustling with business, and on the weekends and after hours, after 5, we'll be open in the tasting room here.
Nice. So what are the plans for the hours when you get fully open?
Yeah, right now we're planning on Thursday and Friday after 5 till 9 p.m. And then Saturday and Sunday, noon to 9 p.m.
So I had the pale wheat and I had the saison. They both got pretty good reviews.
Mm-hmm.
But when you got something else coming up?
We're actually brewing an IPA right now as we film this. We have a 100% Brett beer fermenting right now that, you know, the Brettanomyces takes its time and it'll be on tap when it's on tap. But
yeah.
Definitely some plans for some more Belgian stuff and some more hops in the works.
Nice, awesome. So you were telling me about how awesome this building was.
Yeah.
But I think you tell it better than I do.
Yeah, so we have a 130-year-old building here. It was originally built in the 1880s.
You can't tell it from this, but the outside is gorgeous.
Yeah, there's amazing brickwork and really old wood. They're actually built out of like real 2x12s, 2 inches wide, and it's badass. So this building originally was a livery, so it housed horses. The second floor was used to store hay. Bales of hay is pretty cool.
So come drink in a barn.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of, in a
it
way.
Was originally a barn. The building between us and Starbucks was an alleyway at that point. And they eventually put a roof between the two buildings and turned it into its own building. Kind of a cool story.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
Yeah. 20, 30 years ago, this building was boarded up. There were no windows. You couldn't see in. There were pigeons sleeping in the rafters even. And my in-laws moved in about 10 years ago and totally renovated the place. They sandblasted all the old brick and all the wood, turned it into a great office space. And then when I rolled out my business plan for a brewery, they said, we have a vacant first floor in downtown Santa Ana, and it was just a perfect fit.
Nice. Well, welcome to the neighborhood. This neighborhood keeps getting better and better. I mean, yeah. Native Sun just opened, Worst House is about to open. Mm-hmm. It's getting real exciting out here.
Really cool little craft beer community happening in downtown Santa Ana. And we're also, I would point out, part of like the 57 beer freeway, I guess, connecting all these really cool breweries in
the 57 ends right before here.
Yeah, we're at the very end.
You could take Maine right up here and come all the way up to the 57, and then from there,
you could
just brewery up that way.
Exactly.
So do you plan on distributing anytime soon?
Right now we're figuring out how much beer we need in the tasting room, because this is obviously a big focus for us. We have tons of restaurants and bars that are local that are excited to have our beer on tap, and
yeah,
we'll get that stuff out there as soon as we can.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. So any other crazy plans you got? Any hopes and dreams? Like
Lots of barrel-aged stuff in the works, and we'll do bottle releases once those are finished and ready to go.
Awesome.
I guess my passion, it lies in creating places where people want to spend time, and that's kind of what the tasting room is all about. It's a cool little social place to spend time with your friends and family, and my hope is to kind of replicate that in other cities around California.
It's awesome right here. The only problem right here is parking, quite frankly. Parking, carpool when you come down here, plan to park in front of a meter. The meters turn off at 8 o'clock
out
in this neighborhood, So you can just show up and pay for the 45 minutes and then you're good. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, I'm parked for free right now on Sunday.
Yeah, it's real nice. We have 45 degree parking right here on 4th Street, and then we're about a block away from one structure to the west and one structure to the east.
Oh, I forgot about that one over there.
Yeah, we're surrounded by Birch and 3rd. So a cool thing about Santa Ana, I just learned about this the other day, is all of the parking structures are either on 5th Street or 3rd Street. So if you're driving down 4th, you're going to park on 4th. Drive down 3rd or 5th if you want to find a structure.
That's true, because that's right there. When you go to the playground, you got to go one block north to get into that parking structure.
Exactly.
Same thing, yeah. All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and close up the show. I really thanks for hosting us today.
Thank you very
Cheers.
Much. Thanks for coming. Cheers.